little ones, call up grandma and grandpa, ship them off to the grandparents, take a night off, both parents come, and this is why. We are going to have a teenager versus parent game to see who's better. And now, I don't know about you parents, I'm stubborn, and these kids aren't even my kids, and I want them to know that I'm better than them at everything. And I make that very clear every week. You can ask them. So make sure you come and do that. And then next Sunday, on October 17th, we are having a connection lunch immediately after the service downstairs. So what that means is that if you're new here or newer and you haven't met any of us as a staff, you want to know what Meeting House is about, what we do here, that is the time for you to get to know us. I'll be there, Kayla will be there, our staff is going to be there, Pastor James will be there. So that'll be downstairs immediately after the service. And then also, if you're in middle school or high school, on Friday, October 22nd, from 7 to 8:30, we are going to be having floor hockey. So if you love to play hockey, you just want to come out, hang out, have a good time, you are more than welcome to do that. Everybody is welcome for middle school or high schoolers. Parents, I don't recommend it because they have a whole lot more energy than we do. So, you know, you could just stay home, drop them off, and just relax for a little bit. It's a good time. And then on October 30th, we are having our annual youth group Halloween party. And this year is going to be a little bit different. We are going to be playing Among Us in real life. And at the same time, we're also going to be having a Halloween costume contest. And there will be a prize for who has the best costume. So that's going to be on October 30th from 5 to 8 p.m. Let's go ahead and pray and open up our service this morning. Dear Heavenly Father God, thank you for the day that you've given to us. God, the weather's cooling off outside. It's getting a little bit nicer out. God, we're able to wake up in the morning to come here and worship you. So God, right now, no matter what's going on in our daily lives, no matter what's going on in the weeks to come, God, even this afternoon, I just ask that you help us just to push all those things aside. God, help us to focus on you this morning. God, give everything that we have, God, and just let that not stop here on a Sunday morning. Let that carry throughout our week, that no matter what we do, we are constantly praising you, constantly doing everything for your honor and for your glory. God, let that not just be a Sunday morning thing. Let that be a Sunday to Saturday, 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, just worshiping you. So God, as we go into this morning service, I just ask that you fill this place with your Holy Spirit. You fill Pastor James with your Holy Spirit, God, and that we learn something from your word. In your son's holy name, amen.
Good morning, Meeting House. Please stand with us for worship and we'll get started.
But I will hold my ground. I will worship your holy name. behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes, new life is born. Jesus is calling.
Seated.
Thank you, Mags. Good morning, everybody. How you doing? Yeah, good to see you here. My name is James Thomason. I am the lead pastor here at Meeting House Church. And before I get started, let me dismiss the children. If your kids are here and you check them in for MHC Kids, their teacher will be in the back of the auditorium there. If you didn't check them in and you forgot, you can check them in here at the last minute. Okay, good. Good. Let's see. If this is your first time here with us, or if you've been around and we've never got a chance to say hello, after the service, every Sunday, I'm right back there under the words Connection Center, and I would love it if you would come and say hello to me and we could have a chance to meet. If you have anything you want to pray about or anything, you can always come back there. I'm glad to pray with you. and whoever. And speaking of prayer, I want us to spend a few minutes in prayer this morning before we get started for a few people in our church, okay? Joe Perkins is a longtime member and in our church, and he's having some back problems that are just very painful, keeping him from sleeping, from going to work. He's in not good shape, so he's hurting quite a bit. So I want us to pray for Joe. All right. Then there's two other people, a man and a woman, who are going through some emotional problems, some serious emotional problems, and psychological. And you know, our medical system is great at fixing broken bones, and if you need a transplanted organ, they can do that. But when it comes to the human soul and mind, our medical community doesn't know anything about the soul and the mind. And basically, what I find they do all the time is just throw drugs at the soul and the mind, and they don't work that way. Your brain, if there's an organic problem, that's one thing. But the soul and the mind aren't affected by drugs, aren't improved by medication. And so I want to lift these three people up, young man and woman, and then Joe, okay? So you get together with whoever you came with, or if you came alone, then join somebody or pray alone. That's okay. None of us are alone. God's here. Let's pray. Father God, we acknowledge you are the creator, king, judge, and savior over everything, everywhere, and everyone. God, all that exists that is not you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you created. And all you needed was the power of your words to do it. You designed our bodies, our souls, our spirits. You are the great engineer. Everything is within your power, and you are good, and you are able, and you are willing. So we lift up Joe to you, and we ask you for healing, that you would heal his back, whatever's going on there. I don't think the doctors have figured it out yet, whether it's a pulled muscle or a vertebrae or a rib or a nerve. But we ask for healing in Jesus' name. We ask you to do your work on his body right now. And we lift up this young man and woman, and we ask again, Father, for your work in their hearts, in their minds, in their souls, God, to bring peace, to bring healing, to bring understanding, to bring forgiveness where forgiveness is needed, whether it's them receiving it or them giving it. We ask for your consolation, God. We know you and you alone can set free from sin, whether it's our own sin or sin that someone has done to us. You can set us free. And we pray for healing right now. God, we ask you to do your work in their minds, in their hearts, in their spirits, in their souls. And we thank you for these in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we're in a series called The Church Is. And for the last couple of weeks, prior to our prayer and worship Sunday, we've been talking about the potential of the church. And so 4 weeks ago, we said the church is untapped potential, right? Because the potential of the church is the potential of Jesus. Not because we're anything special, but because we are in him and seated with him in the heavenlies, and he is something special, right? God has placed all things, right, under his feet. And he is head over it all for the church. So the church is largely untapped potential. God has put great potential into his church. And then 3 weeks ago, we learned that the potential of the church is the fullness of Christ. Okay? And the fullness of Christ simply means that, well, it's not a simple concept. It's a giant concept. But what it means is is that God does not hold back from his people or from his church. He has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms in Christ. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, he's given us all things that pertain to life and godliness through our knowledge of him. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, okay? And a state of fullness is when we come to know and understand God's blessings to us, believe them, live according to them, live in love and obedience to God, and then we experience in our lives all that God has for us. Okay? We defined it as with the vision statement of Meeting House Church, which is a body of believers who experience everything Jesus Christ is to us and who accomplish everything he has for us. That's a state of fullness. That's what it means to live in the fullness of Christ. And today, big mouthful. The church has the potential to do the same things Jesus did. Can you remember that and say it with me? Let me say it one more time, then we'll all try to say it together. The church has the potential to do the same things Jesus did. All right, ready? The church has the potential to do the same things Jesus did. Okay? Now, that doesn't mean we can become the Son of God, right? That's nonsense. Okay, to do the same things Jesus did. It doesn't mean that we can do only that which the Son of God could do, die for the sins of the world and rise again and pay for our own sin. We can't, or anybody else's. We can't do that. But this is what Jesus said during the Last Supper, the night before he was arrested and crucified. Let's look at that in John chapter 14. And let me just say this. John chapter 13, 14, 15, 16, and 17. The Gospel of John, 13 through 17, chapter 13 through 17. Incredibly important chapters in the Bible. Now, all of the Bible is God's Word. But what Jesus is doing right there is preparing his disciples for life after he has died, risen, and returned to heaven. It's a preparation. And so that means that everything that Jesus says in chapters 13 through 17 apply directly to us. Okay, very important chapters in the Bible. You should read those over and over and over again. So here is Jesus in John chapter 14, starting in verse 11. He says to them and to us, "Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me." In other words, I'm the Son of God. I am God. God is my Father. He is God. I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves. Now that word works could be translated miracles. In some translations of the Bible it is. But it's fine as works. It means all. It means everything. All the works that Jesus did. Okay? Believe on the evidence of the works that I am doing and that I have done. Very truly, I tell you, now help me out with these next highlighted words. Whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing. The potential of the church is to do the same things that Jesus did. Whoever believes in me will do the works that I have been doing. And they will do what? Even greater things than these. So the church, according to Jesus, has the potential to do not only the works that Jesus did, but greater works than Jesus did, right? It takes me back a little bit to even say that, right? Now, not because we're better than Jesus, but he explains why. Why? Because I am going to the Father. That's why we should be able to do the works that Jesus did and even greater things, because he is going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. Or in other words, so that I may bring glory to the Father. Okay? Now let's break this down a little bit. Whoever believes in me, Jesus said. I'd like an answer here. Did Jesus say that only the apostles will be able to do the works that I have been doing? No. Didn't say that, did he? He said, whoever. Did Jesus say only the early church would be able to do the works that he had been doing? No. He said, whoever believes in him will do the works that I have been doing. Okay? Another question. Yes or no answer. Are you and I whoever? If we believe in him, then we fall under whoever, right? Okay, so can we get some agreement here that this statement of Jesus applies to us, Meeting House Church, as a group and as individuals right now? Yes. Okay, good. We've got some common understanding we can build on, right? That's a mouthful, okay? It's a mouthful. It's almost unbelievable if Jesus hadn't said it. Now, he says, he explains why. Because I am going to the Father. Now, we learned this a few weeks ago. When Jesus returned, ascended to heaven, God sat him at his own right hand and put everything under his feet. Right? Every rule, authority, power, and dominion. Every title that can be given, not only in this age, but also in the one to come, is under Jesus' feet, and he stands in domination over all of it. Jesus dominates everything. He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. There are no rivals to Jesus Christ. Okay? So, and God appointed him as head over who? Us. The church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way, right? That's Ephesians chapter 1. Prayer from verse 17 to the end of the chapter. That's what we just looked at right there. Okay? So those are all realities. Right now, Jesus sits in heaven at God's right hand, and we are seated with him in the heavenlies, and all of it is under Jesus' feet. He's conquered it all. Okay? And he said, when I return to the Father, I will send someone to you. The promised Holy Spirit. So Jesus says, because I am going to the Father, this will happen. We will do the works that he's been doing and do even greater things than these. Number one, because he is head over us, the church, and he rules over it. So he can accomplish through us whatever he chooses to accomplish, right? And he has empowered us, poured out his Holy Spirit on us, and put his Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit lives in us, right? And the Holy Spirit is God's presence and power in us to do these things, okay? So this is not our power, this is God's power in us and through us. Everybody got that? Okay, this is a reality. Okay, we may not be experiencing it. As a matter of fact, we aren't. When did this whole pandemic thing start? When did they shut everything down? I'm losing track of years. 2020, February? What? March? Okay, March. I can't tell the difference between 2019. It's like... But when we started a series in the book of Acts back then when they shut everything down, and I decided that I was going to, you know, the church was going to be empty. It was going to be a ghost town, and it was. You know, we had our band, and there was nobody in the seats. We were just playing to the camera, and you guys were all at home watching on TV. Nobody would come to the church, right? Everything was shut down. I'm like, man, I'm going to have all kinds of time on my hands. I am going to spend as much time as I can stand with God in prayer, reading his word. And God led me to a series, to the book of Acts, okay? And we spent a year in the book of Acts. And here's what we discovered. Let me give you a... The church has lost knowledge, biblical knowledge of God and of the Holy Spirit. We haven't lost right doctrine, okay? but the church has lost, at some point, the American church lost its relational knowledge of God. Okay? Let me give you an example. In 1799, two or three of Napoleon's soldiers, Napoleon was on campaign in northern Africa, and in 1799, they came across this stone that had three different languages on it. One was Greek, ancient Greek. The other one was hieroglyphics. And the other one was the common language of Egypt at the time. Now, Greek was known at the time. The common language of Egypt was known at the time. But hieroglyphics, nobody on planet Earth had had knowledge of how to read hieroglyphics for 400 years. Think about that. The knowledge of a language had passed off the earth for 400 years. Napoleon knew he had something there. He took it back to France, and scholars used the Greek and the common language of the Egyptians to figure out hieroglyphics. And for the first time in 400 years, the knowledge of hieroglyphics was regained. Okay? That stone's called the Rosetta Stone. What's happened, certainly in the American church, is that we, for a long time, have lost a relational knowledge of God, a real relational knowledge of the Holy Spirit. We live on principles. We live, and nothing wrong with biblical principles. We live on diet, you know, we read God's word, and here's some principles, here's some truths. Now let me learn that and apply it to my life and make sure I obey it. And can I tell you, that's not biblical Christianity. Biblical Christianity is not learning some stuff from a book and then applying it to my life. That's not biblical Christianity. That's a lost knowledge. That's a situation where our knowledge is lost. Biblical Christianity is living in relationship with the one true and living God, okay, who is alive and who dwells within you through the Holy Spirit. Because of Christ, and who works inside of you and on you to teach you and to change you and to conform you into the image of Christ. Okay? And we've gone, you know, there's a lot more to say about that, but I'm going to stop right there. So we've gone down this path of basically Christianity is acknowledging some historical truths about Jesus Christ, which are part of it. Okay? That's part of it. I'm not diminishing that. Okay? And then saying, I believe that. And then reading this book and saying, well, here's some great rules for life. Let me now follow them. That's not biblical Christianity. It's not what God intended. And so I really think, and this is, I think God is leading us back to a biblical Christianity. Okay? All the truths will stay the same. All the doctrines will stay the same. We've held on to those, okay? So that's where we stand, and we need to be brought back here. So Jesus says this amazing thing. So what are the works that Jesus did that we're supposed to be doing? Okay? Well, when John the Baptist had been thrown in jail, he sent two of his disciples to Jesus with a question. Are you the Messiah, or should we look for someone else? And Jesus said, go back and tell John that I do the deeds of the Messiah. The blind receive sight. The lame walk. The sick are healed. The deaf hear again. Good news is preached. And more. Those are the deeds that Jesus did. Do you believe Jesus? That we, Meeting House Church, because of all that I've already said, have the ability, can and should be doing the works that Jesus did. Okay? Now, the problem is that because of this lost knowledge, listen, the church for years has turned this into some kind of nice mythological saying. It means somehow we'll be good people like Jesus was a good person. We've dumbed it and watered it down to mean not what Jesus says. We've settled for something less because that's been our experience. It's what's been passed down to us, okay? And we have to stop that. We have to stop it. Very few Christians believe that this is possible. Very few. That the church should on a regular basis be doing the works that Jesus did, and even greater. The vast majority don't believe that Jesus meant what he said here. They believe that it's somehow some kind of just, and Jesus' sayings are always, his words are always, people consistently do this. They just turn them into some kind of nice, feel-good thing. That, oh yeah, okay, so I'll be a good person. Jesus went around doing good, I'll go around doing good. We just don't think it's possible. So today we're going to work through six works that Jesus did, okay? And we're going to go slow. We're going to look at the biblical data, all right? We're going to go slow for the purpose of just, if nothing else, just me just forcing you to deal with this, okay? And myself to deal with it, okay? Six works that Jesus did that the book of Acts church also did, and we'll see that we should also be doing. Okay, everybody got that? That's a pattern. We're going to stick with all six of them. Did Jesus said we do the works he did? Did he do them? Yes. Did the book of Acts church do them? Yes. Are we doing them? So I want to ask you to maybe use this as a diagnostic for yourself. Grade yourself. I thought about giving Meeting House Church a letter grade on each one of these, okay? But then I realized our GPA would be really low. So let's take a look at this. Now, one more thing before we get started. The first three are foundational. The second three grow out of the first three. If you and I and we are not doing 1, 2, and 3 works, we cannot expect 4, 5, and 6 works. Okay? The first three are the ground that the second three grow out of. Okay? Very important for us to realize. All right, number one. We're going to start. This is going to be like, you're going to be disappointed when you hear this. Jesus loved and obeyed his Father God. Work number one. What was the works? What are the works? Jesus loved and obeyed his Father God. Okay? Again, on the night of the Last Supper, before he was arrested and crucified, John chapter 14, starting in verse 30. I will not say much more to you, for the prince of this world, that's Satan, is coming. He has no hold over me. In other words, I have no sin. Satan has no rule over me, none whatsoever. But he comes so that the world may learn that I love the Father and do exactly what my Father has commanded me. Okay? Now, the normal American church, so we have the BOAC, right? That's the Book of Acts church and Book of Acts Christians, okay? And then we have the NAC, the normal American church and normal American Christians, okay? I'm going to use those acronyms today, okay? So, we hear all the time that the reason that Jesus died for our sins is because of how much he loves us. God, Jesus loves you so much that he died to save, he took on the justice, the punishment, the wrath of God for your sins so that you could be forgiven. And that's reason number two. Not reason number one. Okay? You are not at the center of Jesus' heart. I am not at the center of Jesus' heart. God the Father is at the center of Jesus' heart. The primary reason that Jesus left heaven, came to earth, lived a sinless life, right, as our high priest, our representative, died as our sacrifice, rose again, victorious over our sin, and returned to heaven, was his love for the Father. His love for the Father. His love for us is secondary. The second thing, the second most important thing to him. Okay? And this is a, man, there's just so much to say here. I got to keep from getting tripped up. But the normal American church has moved God and Jesus out of the center of the gospel and put us at the center of the gospel. The normal American church thinks, preaches, and teaches that God revolves around us. God is here to bless me and mine. The normal American church says, hey, invite Jesus into your life, and he's going to make everything okay. The biblical gospel is really God coming to us and inviting us into his life. Our normal approach is, hey, believe in Jesus. He's going to make all my plans and my family and my life and my finances and everything just go hunky-dory, and it's going to be, I'm just, as long as I stay on the yellow brick road with Dorothy and the Tin Man and the Lion, then everything's going to be cool. And it's not the gospel. The gospel is God loves you so much, he wants to invite you into his life to be a part of what he is doing now and forever. That's the gospel. Okay? So Jesus is, he loved and obeyed his Father God above everything. It's what kept him sinless so that he could become sinful for us. It's why he loved the Lord his God with all his heart, soul, mind, and strength, and his neighbor as himself. It's why he was willing to die as our sacrifice. The book of Acts, church, loved and obeyed God. The second time Peter and John were arrested for preaching the good news about Jesus, as they stood before the authorities, and as the authorities threatened them, hey, don't teach anymore in this man's name. After they flogged them and beat them, tortured them for teaching in Jesus' name and teaching that Jesus was Messiah and telling people who didn't believe in Jesus that they needed to believe in him because he is the Messiah, and if they don't, they're separated from God because of their sin. The authorities said this in Acts chapter 5, verse 28. We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name, he said. That's the high priest. Yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you're determined to make us guilty of this man, that's Jesus' blood. Peter and the other apostles replied, help me out, what did they say? We must obey God rather than men. You see, for the book of Acts Christian, it wasn't a debate whether or not they were going to follow the culture or God, whether they were going to obey powers and authorities that told them to disobey God, whether they were going to shut up when God told them to speak up. It wasn't, they didn't go through every time there was a tension, a process of, wow, should I obey God here? No, the first and greatest commandment, Jesus said, is to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength. And it all starts right there for us. If we don't love and obey God, we can pretty much forget the rest. Okay, the rest is just, it's not going to happen, right? Now, next week, we're going to take a deeper look into this. Because we've got to, first thing is we've got to identify the problem, right? And the American church isn't, I think God has identified the problem for us, okay? But we've got to acknowledge it, right? If you don't know you're sick, you don't go to the doctor, right? Then we got to look at the solution. And next week, we're going to start to look at the problem and the solution. So we're going to look at the potential the church has to do this. Bottom line is, man, this is tough. We really don't love and obey God the way the Book of Acts church and Christians did. We just don't. And we need to acknowledge that. We got to acknowledge the truth. John chapter 14, verse 21, Jesus says this. Next slide. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. See, in Jesus' mind, love and obedience go together, right? Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. Okay? The Book of Acts Christians chose to love and obey God when it meant rearranging their schedules so they could be with one another. The Church of Acts Christians chose to love and obey God when it meant sacrificially giving to help others in need. The Book of Acts Christians loved and obeyed God when it meant being arrested for obeying Him. The Book of Acts Christians loved and obeyed God when it meant being killed for Him. At every level, they loved and obeyed God. From the daily schedule to being arrested and killed rather than disobey God. The normal American church says, yeah, it's important. We must love God. But obedience is optional. This is difficult for me to say. Because I sit back and I think through my history in the church, my personal history. I think about the churches that I know and everything. And I think that's an honest assessment. The normal American church says it's possible to love God but not obey Him. That we've separated the two. Jesus said, whoever loves me will obey me. Our love flows into and out of obedience. We have loving obedience and obedient love for God. Okay? Now, I'm not saying perfect. I'm not saying perfection. Don't get me wrong. But we've come to the conclusion that we can love God but not really obey Him at least rarely. But Jesus said if we love Him, we will obey Him. So let's diagnostic. What about us? What about you and me? Do we think we can love God without obeying Him? Can we believe without loving? Many churches, can we believe without obeying? Can we love without obeying? I think that the kind of normal consensus in America is yes. We can believe without loving. We can believe without obeying. We can believe without repenting. Just believe Jesus is up there, that He did something 2,000 years ago, that He rose from the grave, and you're good. And it's not biblical. It's not the truth. Okay, so I would give, that's not, we don't, I think, I certainly know that our aspiration here at Meeting House Church is to love and obey. I know that. I know that most of your aspiration is to love and obey. Okay, I know that. But we want to, let me just keep going. Number two, second work, Jesus was devoted to prayer. Can you imagine that? The Son of God, who was God himself, right, was devoted to prayer. Devoted. It wasn't something Jesus only did in time of crisis. It wasn't something that he did when he decided he had, you know, when his schedule wasn't too busy and he could squeeze God in for a couple of minutes. It wasn't. It was he lived a lifestyle of prayer, of interaction with God. Luke chapter 15. And we read statements like this throughout the gospel, starting in verse 15. Yet the news spread about him, Jesus, all the more, so that the crowds of people came to hear him, and he healed them of their sicknesses. But Jesus, what did he do? He often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. When I taught at Boston Baptist College, I used to say this. If Jesus had to live like Jesus in order to be like Jesus, then we need to live like Jesus in order to be like Jesus. So what I'm telling you is Jesus was 100% man and 100% God, right? Hypostatic union, that's a theological term for that. Can I fully explain it or anyone? No, but that's what he was, 100% man and 100% God. And as 100% man, he needed to pray. And he wanted to pray. Right? Prayer is essential to loving and obeying God. It's having a conversation with God, the God who loves you, who sacrificed his son to die for you, to give you life, now and forever, eternal, to bring you to himself, to invite you to live your life in his life, to become a part of what the King is doing on planet Earth and throughout eternity. If we pray, and these next two are interdependent, right? If I spend time with God in prayer, then he's going to grow my love for him and my obedience for him. He's going to work on me in an extra special way, and he's going to change me during that time when I'm with him and with him alone. So prayer feeds back into my love and obedience to God. It's like a feedback loop. It's both a result and a cause of my love for God and obedience for God. The book of Acts, church and Christians were devoted to prayer. Acts chapter 3, verse 1. One day, Peter and John were going up to the temple. When were they going up to the temple? At the time of prayer, at 3 in the afternoon. So I want you to imagine arranging your life like this. Doesn't have to be 3 in the afternoon. But at some set time every day for you, it was the hour of prayer, the time of prayer. Everything stopped. Every other obligation, every other voice, every other intrusion into your life stops. And you get one-on-one with God himself. And you block it all out. And you be with the God who loves you and created you. That's what they did. Every day. Now, it was the Jewish way. They had 3 in the afternoon. I did some studying in England back in the early 2000s, right? And they had tea time. You know, tea time was cool. I'd never experienced anything like that, but I'd be there in the library studying, and all of a sudden they roll the cart out with the teas and biscuits, which are cookies and crackers in our language, right? And everything stops, and then everybody kind of gets up and sits and chats for 15 minutes and then goes back, right? Like that, twice a day. Personal one-on-one prayer with God every day. Not only did they pray personally, they prayed as a congregation. Let's look at that, Acts chapter 12, verse 12. When this had dawned on him, Peter has just gotten out. An angel has miraculously broken Peter out of jail in the middle of the night. He's been arrested again for obeying God, preaching the gospel, and an angel comes and breaks him out. And he says, when this had dawned on him, he thought he was having a vision, but he realized, hey, my feet are on the street, and I'm headed towards Mary's house. He went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. Congregational prayer, God's people gathered together praying, was a regular part of the life of the Book of Acts church. Is it a regular part of your life? Is it a regular part of Meeting House Church? We've already said, folks, I've been a Christian for a long time now. I'm getting old. 1987. I have never been part of a church, and I've been part of some good churches. I mean, with some people that love the Lord. But I've never been part of a church that regularly got together to pray. Now, there were prayer meetings here and there, preparation for things. But, hey, we're here together to speak with God, to be with God in prayer. We do that, by the way, every Monday night here at 6:30. We do it once a month, first Sunday of every month here, prayer and worship Sunday. Now, I'm going to say something that really... Prayer and Worship Sunday is actually my favorite Sunday of the month. It's our least attended Sunday of the month. And without fail, attendance drops on the day that we gather together to pray together to God. Right? It's just the truth, you know? I'm just laying it out there. It's, right? Because... it's different. Prayer is different. We're being active instead of passive, right? We're interacting. We got to open up a little bit. I mean, when we put the chairs in horseshoes a few weeks ago, a couple of months ago, for Prayer and Worship Sunday, you talk about polar opposite responses. Some people were like, oh, that was great. Let's do it again. Other people were like, what in the world? How can you do that? I had to sit with people I don't know. It made me feel uncomfortable. Like, get over it. You're a brother. They're your brothers and sisters in Christ. How about we just love one another? Hey, how you doing? My name's James. What's your name? Robert? Robert, great to meet you. Man, I can't wait to pray with you today. What's wrong with that? Right? What's wrong with a little love for one another? Devoted to prayer. Acts 2:42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and prayer. Prayer. Prayer is an implicit statement of faith in God. You realize that? No prayer is an implicit statement of no faith in God. The normal American church, prayer is optional. Congregational prayer, rarely to never. Very few American Christians pray every day. For us, Meeting House Church, I'd give us maybe... I was a hard teacher. Maybe a C, C plus. We're getting there. We've got some activities, but boy, it's not what it can be, man. The potential one of these prayer and worship Sundays, man, we're gonna get it. We're gonna let God in, and it's gonna be awesome. It's gonna be awesome. Okay? I can't wait to I gotta shut up and move faster here. But this is, listen, our lack of devotion to prayer, to speaking to God, is why we live so far below our potential. It's one of the real reasons why. Okay? Number three, Jesus was devoted to the scriptures, God's written word. Okay? Imagine the Son of God, right? Think Jesus had a hand in writing the scriptures? Yeah. He was devoted to them. He knew them. He learned them as a human being. Jesus believed the scriptures were true. He trusted God's word. Listen to what he says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 17. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. For them, that meant the entire Old Testament, the law and the prophets. He's just saying the Old Testament, the scriptures. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Jesus believed every word written in God's word. When it talked about a future kingdom, when God will rule the earth, when God's coming back to judge all of humanity and then set up his physical kingdom here on earth, Jesus said, yep, that's going to happen. Right? When Jesus read about Moses parting the Red Sea and the people of Israel walking through it on dry land, Jesus said, yep, it happened. When Jesus read about Noah and God flooding the entire earth in judgment, but in grace saving Noah and his family to start over again, Jesus said, yep, it happened. When Jesus read Jonah getting swallowed by a fish, carried and spit out at the shore so he could go to Nineveh and preach, Jesus said, yep, it happened. The normal American church says, nope, that's all nonsense. So many churches, that's mythology. That's just so many Christians. Nope, didn't happen. Okay, that stuff can't happen. Like, water doesn't part. Like, you can't explain that to me. You got gravity pulling down on it. Like, what happened? You know, was there, you know, I've read all kinds of naturalistic attempts to explain those things naturalistically. Well, a big down blast blew the water apart, you know, or it's all kinds of nonsense. Well, yeah, it makes sense because God is king over everything. He rules the elements. If God wants to part water, he can part it, right? You say, how could Jonah, is there a fish big enough to swallow Jonah? Wait, how could he survive inside a fish's belly for 3 days? That's not physically possible. It doesn't have to be. God is alive. God could do, you know, he could do CPR on Jonah while he's inside the fish's belly. You know what I mean? It's like, there's no faith. There's no faith. The book of Acts church was devoted to the scriptures. Acts chapter 24, verse 14, a statement of Paul when he was on trial for obeying God. I admit that I worship God, the God of our ancestors, as a follower of the way, which they call a sect. I believe everything that is in accordance with the law and that is written in the prophets. Paul believed it all. He didn't write any of it off. Acts 2:42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, right? The apostles' teaching became the New Testament, okay? We have the apostles' teaching in the New Testament, devoted to the scriptures. The normal American church believes that devotion to the scriptures is optional. I can't tell you how many people who call themselves Christians tell me that there's more ways to heaven than Jesus, than explicit faith in Jesus. When Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, no one comes to the Father except through me, he didn't really mean that. He didn't? God has some other way? Wait, aren't Allah and Jehovah the same God? Nope, they're not. Wait a second, you mean that's a sin? Yeah, wait, but I mean, everybody's doing it. Like, isn't that kind of like, to think that's a sin, isn't that wrong? I mean, aren't you wrong? Aren't you bigoted to think? Well, I believe God and his word. Wait, that's righteousness? I should do that? Yeah, you should. It's just that simple. So I think in our church, we have a wide range here, right? Some of us are mature. We're devoted to the scriptures. We spend time reading God's word, right? Let me just skip to this. Prayer and reading God's word are the language, the foundational language of relationship with God. We cannot know God apart from his word. Okay? This is the revelation. This is the information that God has given to us so that we can know him. Okay? So that we must be devoted to prayer and to God's word. Number four, Jesus proclaimed the gospel to non-believers. I'm going to speed up here, okay? He evangelized. Like, that's a cuss word now. Like, if you say evangelism in polite company today, Like, what's wrong with you? Are you some kind of religious colonialist? Are you trying to you trying to push, you know, Western culture on the world? Or no, I'm trying to push Jesus. Right? After this, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. Jesus did not faint to preach the good news of the kingdom of God to people who didn't believe it. He did it his entire life. The book of Acts church proclaimed the gospel to non-believers. Acts chapter 8, verse 1. And Saul approved of their killing him. That's Stephen. Saul became the apostle Paul. But at this point, he was an enemy of the church and participated in the execution of Stephen, who was killed for obeying, loving and obeying God. On that day, a great persecution broke out against the church in Jerusalem. And help me out with this. All except who? The apostles were scattered. A persecution by the Jewish religious leaders started that day in Jerusalem, and they scattered everybody out of town except for the apostles. This is an important point, okay? Throughout Judea and Samaria, everybody scattered except for the apostles. Saul began to destroy the church, going from house to house. He dragged off both men and women and put them in prison. Verse 4, those who had been scattered, what did they do? They preached the word wherever they went. Philip, as an example, went down to Samaria and proclaimed the Messiah there. Now, here's one of the things we do in the normal American church. Well, the apostles, they preached the gospel. That was their job. They went out and shared the gospel with lost people. They told lost people about Jesus, right? Pastors and missionaries are supposed to go out and share the gospel with lost people and tell them about Jesus. But I'm just a regular Christian. That's not my job. That's for apostles and that's for pastors and everything. Those all except the apostles were scattered. And they preached the word wherever they went. Right? For the normal American Christian, proclaiming the gospel is optional. It's just, like, it breaks my heart every time I do research and look at studies and surveys. Upwards of 90% of American Christians will never share salvation, share Jesus with a lost person. Never. Can you imagine that? The one person that can rescue people from life and eternity, separated from God, right, in just punishment for their sin, is Jesus. And most Christians will never say a peep about him to a lost person. And even fewer will ever lead another person to faith in Jesus. That is scandalous disobedience on the part of the church. Scandalous. Yet we continually consider it optional. I include myself there, okay? I include myself there. But this is one that so many people just give themselves a pass on. But Jesus said, you will be my witnesses. He said, go and make disciples. He said, this gospel of the kingdom must be preached to the whole world. And we're the people to do it. Okay? We have the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And those keys are the gospel. Okay? Number 5, Jesus fed the hungry and cared for people in need, right? I'm going to speed up here a little bit, right? He fed 5,000. Let me just read the first part of this, Matthew chapter 15. Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I have compassion for the people. Right? They'd been following around for days. Most of them were poor. Most of them didn't know where their next meal was from. And so Jesus, right, they found some loaves of bread. Jesus performed a miracle, fed 4,000 men, plus women and children, because he had compassion. He cared, right? Second greatest commandment, love your neighbor as yourself. He cared about other people so much that he was willing to help them. The book of Acts church fed the hungry and cared for people in need. Acts chapter 6, verse 1. In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the church is up above 5,000 at the believers in Jerusalem now. were increasing. The Hellenistic Jews, the Greek Jews, among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in what? The daily distribution of food. Imagine how many widows there must have been in a church of at that time of over 5,000 people. I mean, there must have been hundreds, right? Hundreds. Lifespan was short. The economy wasn't like it is right now. A widow just couldn't go out and get a job. Things were different back then. But every day they cared so much that they made sure that these widows had food to eat. They took care of them. And they created a special group of seven men who were filled with who were known to be filled with the Holy Spirit and wisdom to take care of this ministry. And that's one of the steps. I feel on congregational care, we do a pretty good job here at Meeting House Church, but one of the next steps we're going to take is finding seven men who are known to be full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom to do this. Because we have some people here that right now that they just can't make it. Not because of their situation in life. And we need to be loving on them. We need to be caring for them. Okay? Number six, Jesus performed miraculous signs and wonders. He healed the sick. He made the handicapped walk. He freed people who were demonized. Matthew chapter 4, starting in verse 23. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. News about him spread all over Syria, and the people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain and demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. He healed them. The book of Acts, Christians healed people who were sick, handicapped, and demon-possessed. God performed miraculous signs and wonders through them. Acts chapter 8, verse 5. Philip went down to the city of in Samaria and proclaimed the Messiah there. When the crowds heard Philip, was Philip an apostle? He was not. He was one of the six men that were chosen who were full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom to help take care of the widows. Philip, when the crowds heard Philip and saw the angels, the signs he performed, they all paid close attention to what he said. For with shrieks, impure spirits came out of many, and many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. Normal American church, there's many churches in America that don't believe any of the miracles in the Bible. They believe they were all added later. Jesus never did a miracle, okay? Many American Christians believe, yeah, Jesus did miracles, but God doesn't do those things now. Yeah, the apostles did miracles, or God did a miracle through the apostles, but God doesn't do that now. This is where the normal American church stands, okay? But Jesus said, whoever believes in me will do the works that I have been doing and will do even greater things than these. Other American Christians think that if a church is claiming that God is doing miracles, signs, and wonders in their church, then they are false teachers in a false church. It's messed up. It scares me to folks like it. We're in bad shape. We are in struggling for words, a calamitous situation. We are in a scandalous situation. What we have experienced as normal biblical Christianity is not. It is not. We've believed the right things. Don't get me wrong. Okay, I'm not saying that. All right, but we're not doing what Jesus said we should do, okay? Now, I just want to share some good news here. And I think God is leading us in the direction. I think we are seeing that God is we are seeing inklings, just the very first fruits of what God wants to, he wants to bring us to be a Book of Acts church and Book of Acts Christians. And we're seeing the very first fruits of this. I mean it. I think so. Rhonda right here, God healed her of two things, okay? He healed her back whatever was wrong with that for years, he healed it. She has a thyroid issue, and that causes eye pain and pressure. God healed her eyes. Okay, Valerie, he healed Valerie. She was just spontaneously during prayer and worship Sunday. She was walking with a cane when she came here and couldn't walk at all. She was down and discouraged with life. And the day God healed her, and since people came, like, have you seen, like I heard, I can't tell you how many times I heard these words. Have you seen Valerie? Have you seen Valerie? Have you seen what God did to Valerie? You know, then she goes off the next week, and just to prove it, she goes on a hike with her friend Felicia for miles. Just to, God healed Isabella's back the other day. God's, we know Mike told us a testimony of God's freeing him from a demon. Okay. I'll end with this story right here. And maybe one more scripture. There's a young man that just became a believer last week. Okay. And some pretty cool stuff. The story is really cool. Now, our family's been witnessing him to him, sharing the gospel with him, loving him for about 2 years, okay? And he's like anybody else, like we all were beforehand, just kind of, you know, whatever, you can believe anything, it doesn't matter. You know, maybe so, maybe not, you know. Resistant to God, just like all of us, a rebel against God, just like all of us, where we all start. And then God began to work on him. You know, God's love is relentless. You know, when God sets his love on somebody to save him, man, it's hard to get out of. It's hard to get out of. And so God began to work on this young man, and leading up to the apologetics conference was down there last week. At Central Congregational. So we invited him to come to that. He couldn't make it on Friday night, but came Saturday. Well, completely, none of this is known to our son, Nathaniel, Bub, who's out in Eastern and Western Mass going to school, okay? But the day before that conference, one of the guys comes into his cabin, and they're just sitting there, you know, having a session, just talking, joking around. And this kid named Alejandro shares a vision with Bub that God gave him. A very biblical vision of heaven and hell. Scared the snot out of Bub. It did. Now, Bub is not a big talker. You guys, if you that know him, he kind of keeps to himself. But he felt like, man, I got to call this guy that I'm talking about that just became a Christian. I got to call him. And Bub doesn't really know him that well. They're not like best friends or anything. They're, you know. And he tells this young man this vision. Just 12:30 at night. Bub said he called him because he felt like God was telling him, call him, call him. And Bub waited till like 12:20 at night. And he said, well, I'll call and he won't answer and I won't have to do it. Right? But he picks up immediately as soon as he calls him. Right? Tells him this vision. The next day at the apologetics conference, J.P. Moreland is talking about visions and signs and wonders and answered prayer and how you can know that things are coming from God. And then this young man spends about 45 minutes after the conference with J.P. Moreland, and he became a believer. So he's born again, right? And I sat with that young man for a couple hours the other day, you know, and that's what I told him. He's when C.S. Lewis became a believer, he described himself as the most dejected convert in all of England. He didn't want to become a believer. He didn't want it. But God's love is relentless, and God's convincing. Right, when God's drawing you, it becomes, I described to this young man, an inevitable conclusion. You know, you kind of look at the situation and go, well, like I could keep not believing, but boy, it wouldn't make any sense at this point, right? So these are the things that God wants to do with us. Last verse, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. Now to him, that's God, who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine. Is today's message more than you could ask or imagine? Is it kind of beyond your faith right now to believe that we can do the works that Jesus did and even greater things? It's okay. God is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine according to his power that is at work within us. Okay? According to his power that it's work within us. So to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus through all generations forever and ever. Amen. Father God, we love you. We praise you, Lord. God, I pray you take this very simple Bible study that we did today and open our eyes. God, that we would be honest and evaluate ourselves. Do we love and obey you? Are we devoted to prayer? Are we devoted to your scriptures? Do we care? Do we have compassion on those who are in need and the hungry? Are we doing anything about it? Do we proclaim the gospel to those in our lives, our families, our friends, our neighbors, our coworkers that we already know who don't believe in you? God, do we believe that you are able, ready, willing, and able to do miracles, signs, and wonders in the name of your holy servant, Jesus? God, we thank you for the work, the beginning of the work that we're seeing. Lord, we ask you to bring us to the place of repentance, of faith, so that you have free reign in our hearts and our minds and our lives in this church. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey, church, let's stand one more time and close out the service with a song.
You stood before creation, eternity. Thank you.
dismissed. Have a great week. God bless.